y'all don't mind, let's go back to a time we really used to have church. We used to have a good time, praising the Lord, in spirit and in truth.
I love them old
church. That old brother, pick up that old hymn book and
singing,
you knew exactly what he was gonna say. Sisters got happy. Folks start patting their feet, clapping their hands, and all of a sudden, he break off in a song, something like this.
There's a word in the text that needs to really be looked at. It needs to be looked at by the churches of Christ, by those in denominational churches, very carefully. It's a word that, when translated to the English language, did not even sound good. It's a word that I dare not and durst not try to address by letter, for it would only cause us to spend time in enunciation, pronunciation. A word that has no good meaning or good thing in it is for as God is concerned. And the word found in the text around the 26th or 25th verse, where it said that there be no schisms in the church. We serve a God that is a God of unity.
Amen.
Amen. We serve a God that is a God that says that although I am God, Philippians 2, 5, I'm not ashamed, I'm not predisposed as God to come down on this earth and die as man. In fact, he says that I love men so much that I will come down and live as man and among men and even allow man to abuse me, to talk about me. I'm God, but I will manifest myself, John 1 and verse number 14. He was manifested in the flesh, came down and dwelt among us. We beheld his glory, but act like we didn't know him. John 1 verse 11, the Bible says he came to his own and his own received him not. I'm God, but I'm willing to come down for the sake of unifying my people, and I will allow myself to live as man, take on the form of man, thinking not robbery to be equal with God in order to establish my church.
Amen.
Division is so ugly. This word is so ugly that he even prayed against division in the book of John chapter 17. Round the 17th verse, he said, Father, I pray for them, not that those who come, but those that you have given me, and I have not lost any of them. But Father, make them one, even as we are one. First John 5, verse number 7, he said, there are three that bear witness in heaven, blood, the fire, and the spirit, but they're all one. There's something about unity.
Amen.
That God loves. There's something about division that God hates. Division tear up things. You remember when Jesus was trying to explain and teach them concerning the kingdom of God. It was division that he said that a house that is divided cannot stand.
Amen.
And yet we live in a time among men right here, right now, where we are divided on love, divided on duty, and divided on responsibility in the very house of God. This division roars itself very ugly. And I thought that perhaps I would warn us to be careful of division, of any kind of division. There is no such thing as a good division. Any division is a bad division. But what's good is when we're all unified in the spirit and in the body of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The Bible declares that there are schisms among us. So I want to talk to you this morning that and share with you from the subject matter, Skeezers in the Church. Skeezers in the Church. Mm-hmm. Y'all looking at me funny, y'all never heard of the word of a schism. Maybe I help you understand how schism and skeezers go together, because schisms, skeezers, born or bred, schisms and skeezers, they're all cousins, they're all related one to another. Amen. So probably historically, it's important that we look at where schisms and skeezers came from. We know that it is a male chauvinist term that has little to do with truth, that came from the homosexual society. Man by the name, went by the MC name of MC Booty B and Homo D2 in the 1980s, rented the song, She's a Skeezer. And in this song, the Urban Dictionary says that it was determined that it was a woman of low moral, low hygiene, and low class, and filthiness, and stain. And he said that a male Skeezers was someone who dealt with someone like this. But remember, the root of this division is a man that wants to be a woman. Division is never good, and division always has reasons and rooted behind it jealousy and hate and envy. These men who wanted to lay up with other men turned to now a term that went viral in our time across the nation, and we were singing in 1980, "She's a Skeezer." We were participating in homophobic, a homomosity demagogy, if you will. It showed it was a backlash from the gay community against straight women, against your mother, against your sister, against anybody who was a woman who dared carry themselves with the God-given ability to love a man. Amen. Now, to such jealousy and ignorance on our part, we allowed ourselves to classify and divide the woman from the man. But the Bible says that woman came from man. You can't take the man from the woman. You can't take the woman from the man. And if you talk bad about the woman, you talking bad about the man. If you cuss out a woman, you cussing out your mother, because you were born from a woman. When you think poorly of a woman, you think poorly of yourself, because you got mamas, you got aunts, you got nieces, and you don't know how to treat a woman. You don't know there's a problem with women in your life across the board. And yet we sit back and watch this division grow and splinter our population, until finally Whitney Houston got up to sing. She said, "I'm every woman, it's all in me," in response to her culture and time. Oprah Winfrey came behind her and started to shout the same thing. It's now become a mogul in the industry. What happened? Division started to say in how we look at one another, how we treat one another. It is to this end that Paul is writing to the church of Corinth. Paul is writing to the church of Corinth, to a group of people who have become skeezers in the church house. A group of people who seem to think they are better than other people in the church. A group of people who think they know more than somebody else in the church. Y'all know about it like that? A group of people that when you walk in doing the best you can, they raise their nose up at you like they stuff don't. Y'all looking at me funny. I'm talking about them church folk that they ain't never sinned before, and they're a lie, and the truth is not in them. There is no classism in the Lord's church. And I don't care how good you can preach, how good you can sing, how good you can pray, you still a Christian in the Lord's church. God, the same God that loved you and bless you loves me also. When I'm up, when I'm down, forgiveness is for me as well as for you. There is no division in the house of God. That is until Skeezers get involved. I'm right about it. You remember he said in 1 Corinthians 11:18-19, "For when you come together in one place, it is not for just to be eating, but I hear that there be divisions among you, and I partly believe it. There must be also hearers among you. They which are approved may be made manifest among you." What was the division? The division was a doctrinal division. It was the division concerning the communion of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Somebody always, some journey later, always comes along with some bright ideal. But let me tell you one thing. God is settled on his doctrine. And God has never commanded to break bread whenever you want to. To commune on Saturday, or to commune whenever you get ready. God says concerning the division of the doctrine of communion that upon the first day of the week, everybody in my body need to break bread. Remember my death, burial, and resurrection. Acts 20 and verse number 7. God has declared it's not up to you, Skeezers, to decide when you're going to commune, old Skeezer. What you mean on the first Sunday? You Skeezer, who told you to commune on the first Sunday? Every Sunday we ought to be communing. Remember that blood that was shed on Calvary's cross for your sin and mine. It's not mine. It's for part of being in the body of Christ.
Amen.
Everybody's in the body of Christ. Would do what God said. God instituted that stuff. Am I right about it?
Amen.
God instituted it. Somebody, they're 90, they got folk trying to regulate emotion, tell folk whether or not they can shout, whether or not they can say amen, or whether they can clap their hands. I'm that schismatic teacher, because I read in my Bible that God is a spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. And in that word is an emotional worship. I don't know about you, but ain't no Skeezer going to stop me from shouting on Sunday morning when God's been good to me. You don't know what I've been through in my health and my strength. You don't know how hard it was for me to get up in the morning. Every time I lift my hands, you start looking at me. Let me tell you something, Skeezer. God in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 26 to 21, but it continued in Romans 16 and verse number 17. Somebody got some wild idea, they could start a church any kind of way they wanted to. Oh yeah, they got some wild idea that would even make Phoebe a preacher if they wanted to. And women been running around preaching, divided from the body ever since. Contextually, there were folk in Corinth who were trying to do whatever they wanted to based on the talent that they had according to the text. But let me tell you something. While there may be women who can show enough speak and can show enough do this and do that, if they do it outside of the will of God, they're wrong and they're skeezers. They're causing division in the Lord's church. Amen. Amen. Mm-hmm. Not only that, when we look doctrinally at this text, we'll find that God warned against schemes in the church. He warned, he said, now I beseech you, brother, mark them, which cause what?
Division
among you. Mark them that don't want to shout with you. Mark them that want to do stuff in the church that God has not commanded them to do. Mark them that walk away from doctrinal teaching. He said, mark them who are contrary to sound doctrine.
Amen.
What you mean sound doctrine? If we're going to be one body, we got to have one doctrine.
Amen.
And in that one doctrine, you won't find disunity, but you'll find that the doctrine is what brings us together and make us Christian. And it's not undoctrinal every now and again to say amen,
amen,
when you hear the word of God being preached.
Uh-huh.
Not undoctrinal. Not undoctrinal to explore the scriptures. Preach the word to be in season and out of season. It's not undoctrinal to correct folk when they're wrong and lost in the dogma of schizism. Schizers in the church are found in this text having to promote or to accept any kind of life. You remember in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, 10 chapters earlier, you remember that the scriptures taught that there was a man in the Lord's house who wanted to have and make love to his father's wife. And Paul said it is commonly reported. What you mean commonly reported? It's commonly reported that there's fornication in the church house.
Mm-hmm.
Let me stop right here for a minute. Do you know that it's not commonly reported that folk get down in the church house today? That's a depart from to love folk who you're married to and being married for who you're married to a worldly culture that says anything that goes, anything go, let the good time roll, even in the church house. He says it's a shame that there's even one that among you. And that's what you ought to do is stand up, know you not, that a little leaven leaveth the whole bunch. Skeezers in the church house found in 1 chapter 15 to 26 from the idea of that men would somehow elevate themselves over another man. I don't care who it is. There's no elder over a preacher that's going to go to heaven. There's no preacher over an elder that's going to make it to heaven. Why? Because God has already settled that there ain't near one of us nothing but service in Christ Jesus. The fact that we have an argument is a sign of some dogma or some foolishness or some misteaching in the body of Christ. How do you go back to the Bible? I go first into chapter 3. You'll find that some of y'all say that you are Paul and you are Apollos and that we got that going on in the church now. Well, I'm with brother so-and-so and I'm with brother so-and-so and I'm with brother so-and-so. He said, let me tell you something. He that watereth is nothing, he that planteth is nothing, but we're all servants for God has given the increase and not me.
Amen.
Not one of us have anything to do with how the church grows or decreases. God, the head of the church, is over everything.
Amen.
And as soon as we stop messing with each other, as soon as we get off the phones gossiping with each other, as soon as we stop pitting one another and seeking psychological acceptance from one another and live in the spirit that God has given us with the gift that God has given us, there will always be that kind of state division in the church until somebody stand up for unity this morning.
Amen.
Oh, we look at these scriptures, we'll find that God hates this type of behavior, not the person. We'll find that Paul said in Philippians 3, verse number 18, for there are many whom I've told you before often, I've told you weeping and crying, but they have become enemies of the cross, whose God is their own belly. And you know most of the time there's division, there's somebody in a role that they're not supposed to be in. There's somebody trying to lead folk that God hadn't appointed them to lead. There's somebody involved in the working and the moving in the spirit that God will never lead them to. The God that I serve will never have you sit down with somebody and talk about me behind my back. The God that I serve will never lead you to sit down with your brother and sister and plan how to get it. The God that I serve and you serve will never teach you how to tear up a church, but don't use you to build up a church. The God that I serve will never tell you to take your offering and do what you want to, but it'll tell you to help support and undergird the work of the church.
Amen.
The God that I serve will never help you feel comfortable hating or not speaking to somebody.
Uh-huh.
The God that I serve will never guide you or influence you to division, but the God that I serve will always have you unified, not with one another, but in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
And his blood.
Amen.
Oh yes, there's division in the church and Skeezers in the church. And Paul says that there should be no divisions in the church, not based on culture, not based on color, creed, or canonicity. We must be united in the doctrine of Jesus Christ. We must be united in the creed of Jesus Christ, or in his word, and his word. We must be united in the people of Jesus Christ. You know how crazy it is to try to think that there's a white church and a black church and a Latino church of Christ? It's absolutely crazy. There's just one church. You know why I know it's just one church? Because the Bible, back to the Bible I go. Acts chapter 17, around the 27th verse. He is made with one blood.
Amen. Amen.
Oh my God. Somebody get this for me. I'll get this for me. I want to show you something. Acts 17. Anybody can get it. Acts 17. Around the 27th verse. Just stay right there. Because see, there's something wrong with us. We were talking about we united in Christ. And we divide up the kingdom of God. And any church you can go to, that's a divisive statement. Because there's just one church. And when you say any church, meaning if you divide the church up, that's denomination. And even within the church of Christ, don't go to this church. Go to that church. That's divisive in nature. You need to go wherever the Spirit of God is teaching and being led, where you can help the most and do something for the kingdom of God.
Amen.
We're so divided. We're so crazy. We're going to go to hell divided, left and burning, a bubbling hell. Not because we were just this or that, but because we tried to take the church from God and make it our church. And I submit to every one of you who think you have the authority to move when you want to. Let me tell you something. You didn't put yourself in the church, and you can't take yourself out.
Amen.
God said in his word in Acts 2:47, he said, praise God, have faith with all the people. I added to the church daily. I don't know who you think you are, but you have to come in submission to the teachings of Christ and to the man of God.
Amen.
Till there be no division in the kingdom of God. And the reason that you're lost because you're divided on whether or not you follow Christ or you follow your own will. Whose God is your better? Whose end is destruction and misery? I preach unity today, unity tomorrow, and unity forever, not just in man, but in the cross and in Jesus Christ's blood.
Amen.
Till we reach that point, we want to be in a world where there's trouble. Acts 17, I gave you time to get to Acts 17, and 27 or so, he says he made, all right? Wait, 26? Everybody said 26, all right, read it, who got it? Doesn't matter who got it. Acts 17, 26, we can get to that. These people will go home. Hold on a minute. He's made what?
Made of one blood.
He's made of one blood.
All nations.
Of men. All right.
For to dwell on all.
Now hold on a minute. Do you not know that one rendering of this text says, for one man has he made every nationality to live over the whole earth, and has determined the appointed time. Do you understand there really is none of this different coloration of people with God? All God sees is the blood that runs through your body and the spirit he gave you.
Amen.
You have made black whiteism and all this racist stuff go on. But God said, I took one man, and from the one man I have made every nationality come from that one man.
Amen.
There's something mentally wrong with you when you think that you're better than somebody else, and it causes schisms in the body. And from that came a white church, a black church, and a Latino church, when we're all just one church.
Amen.
Because we came from one man.
Mm-hmm.
That was that, and we were saved by one man. Am I right about it? His name was Emmanuel.
Amen.
God with us. He's saying everybody, regardless of color, skin, but doctrine mattered. Am I right about it?
Amen.
Because he made one doctrine.
Uh-huh.
And in that one doctrine, saved that one body.
Uh-huh.
And that one body is the church of Christ. Am I right about it? Romans 16 and verse number 17. You can find any other body in the church, just let me know. Romans 16 and 16, the Bible says, salute each other with a holy kiss, for the churches of Christ salute you.
Mm-hmm.
That schism need to know that when you act as schismatic or schizers in the church, that you affect the body and the body starts to move different ways and gyrate different ways. You need to know that everything that you do, the expression on your face, your conduct in your life, the stuff that comes out of your mouth will cause a schismatic reaction in the one body. Am I right about it? You need to know that the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse number 12, for there is one body who has many members. You need to know that all the members are the one body, being many are one in Christ. Am I right about it? There's not many bodies sticking out everywhere, but there's just one body, and that body is the church of Christ. One body has one head. Am I right about it? You need to know the Bible says in Colossians 1:18, for he is the head of the body. Stop by to tell you, you need to shut your mouth if you weren't called to be the head, for he has the preeminence all by himself. Amen. You need to shut up running your mouth about the body and just do your part. If you a hand, be a hand. If you a foot, be a foot. If you an eye, be an eye. If you a tongue, hold your peace sometime. Everybody, tell them God needs you. If you are ear, you need to hear something. Whatever you are, do what you're supposed to do. The body is depending on you to do your part in the body.
Amen.
It's amazing that all the stuff, who you are the head, and you can't even close up against hatred. Mm-hmm. But you let your mouth run loose with gossip. Here you are, feet that won't walk to help a person pick up a loaf of bread. Mm-hmm. That wouldn't walk to the hospital and visit somebody. Mm-hmm. But you let your ear hear how somebody got in the hospital in the first place. Mm-hmm. Girl, I ain't gonna walk down to that hospital because he was in sin when he got in there. I heard that he had done something wrong. And you know me, I'm not the one to gossip, but what I heard is that he got into some stuff, and I ain't going down there. Your feet were made to go bring the glad tidings of God to everybody who needs the gospel. And when I'm sick, when I'm in trouble, that's when your feet should be moving toward me.
Amen.
Oh, we got stinking feet and some clean shoes. Shoes that are too big, that can't fit because you won't walk in the footsteps of Christ.
Yeah.
Oh, but when we get to be one body, ain't it gonna be all right? Mm. Wanna be all right?
Amen.
We get to understand that what you do affect me, and what I do affect you. We start to realize that we don't own the church. This is the Lord's church. Am I right about
Amen.
It? We realize that training these little games, the attendance games, and these little stunts that we pull need to go according to the one doctrine, need to be according to the one faith, to the one hope. Ephesians 4 and verse before, get that for me, Ephesians 4 and verse before, that sound apropos. When we learn it one day that, here's my position, here's my hypothesis, which means that not the word of God, but if I could just do this for a minute, I'm going to suggest to you that the only reason that folk don't make the heaven will not be because they were full of sin. The reason I suggest this is because every one of us are going before God having sinned. I think that it's a whole nother thing when you mess with his church.
Amen.
I think that folk that try to kidnap and vanquish and hurt folk and put folk out the church and lied and tore down their brother have a far more reaching, overarching problem than a person who was strung with alcohol and whiskey, because God knows what it is. But when you mess with his children, he said it had been better for you to wrap a millstone around your neck and plunge down in the sea than to put your mouth on the child of God.
Amen.
I think that's a stern warning for us. There's a stern warning. We better be careful how we treat each other, because I'm a part of the body. And if you don't hurt when you cause me to hurt, you cause the body to be affected. Did y'all get that? Did y'all get that?
Yeah.
Let me tell you something. Watch this. God even said, let me tell you about it. He said, talk to somebody. He said, let me tell you something about it. I believe in Colossians 3:13, I think that's the one. Colossians 2:12. When he said, I want you to forgive each other.
Mm-hmm.
As I've forgiven you. Mm-hmm. He said, well, here's the problem. Because you got to stop asking me to do something for you. Mm-hmm. You're not willing to do for somebody else.
Amen.
Let me say that again. I need you to forgive others as I have forgiven you. Now, if you're not going to do that, and you're going to still hate it or hurt, you've got to stop asking me to forgive you.
Mm-hmm.
Because you can ask me to do something for you that you Can I drink some water right here?
Man.
Somebody say, preach, black men.
Preach.
And I took my water, I'm going to keep on preaching. All right. Amen. Amen.
You want that chat?
All right. All right.
Did you want that verse? You want to read
it? Yeah, yeah.
There is one body.
Ephesians 4, verse 4, there is one body.
And one spirit.
And one spirit.
Heaven is your call.
If you're called, even.
Even.
Uh-huh.
One hope.
To the one hope.
Of your call.
Of your call. All right. All right, read.
One Lord.
One Lord.
One faith.
One faith.
One baptism.
One baptism.
One God.
One God.
And Father of
one
all.
One Father of all.
Who is above all.
Above all.
And through all.
Through all.
And in you.
And in you.
All.
Let me stop at three places. He said there's a God that's higher than any of y'all could ever be. But at the same time, he is low as the lowest person in the church. Y'all have to say amen.
Amen.
Oh yeah, he's low. He walked down the lonely roads of Jericho and took on the cross for our sins and your sins. And went down the Villa Dolorosa carrying his cross on his back for your sins and my sins. He didn't just die for the rich folk. He died for poor folk too. Am I right?
Amen.
He didn't die for the smart folk. He died for folk that didn't have education.
Uh-huh.
He didn't just die for the folk that never did nothing wrong. He said, well, they that did something wrong don't need me. But I'm dying for folk who sin, who's going to sin. Yeah! He said in Romans 5, verse number 8, he said, now listen, while you are yet in sin,
uh-huh,
I died for your ungodly self. There ain't but one that'll do what I'll do. And if you're going to be that one church, one hope, and one faith, you got to get unified in the one body.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. To come to a conclusion, we'll find that these echoes are even sentimental in Ephesians 5:23 concerning marriage itself. In other words, this text is a church of uniformity and not individualism. We got too many people that think that somehow what they feel or think supersedes the needs of the body. Yeah, I know sometimes it don't look like the head doing what it's supposed to do. I know sometimes it don't look like the hand or where they're supposed to be. No, sometimes the feet are sometimes out of position. But just do your part.
Amen.
This is about uniformity, not individuality. And if you're sitting here, a man, a member of the Uptown Church of Christ, and we have to hunt down folk to help us through service, you ought to be ashamed of yourself and everything you stand for. You left the body schismatically functioning. You ought to be ashamed. You ought to shut up. Don't say nothing about nobody. Come down here and repent. Ask God to forgive you. Because there's no way we should be moving schismatic on Sunday morning, because we can't even tell when you come to church or not.
Amen.
Praise God anyhow.
Amen.
Before I take it back, I add some more to it. Amen. I told you I'm not scared of y'all. Amen.
Amen.
All right. All right. I don't know what part I am in the body. Wherever God put me, he know he count on me. I bet you that.
Amen.
I'm glad if he made me a foot, I'll bring the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I'm glad if he made me a knee, I'll bow down and pray in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I'm glad if he gave me a hand, if he made me a hand,